Church family, my name is Miranda, and I want to welcome you to Church for the City, where people far from God find life in Christ. If this is your first time joining us, welcome. We'd love to connect with you. Text GUEST to the number on the screen, or stop by the Connect table on your way out of service and get a free gift. Tonight at 6 p.m. is Awakening Prayer. Awakening Prayer is a time when we come together for an hour of prayer, worship, and a time to go deeper into the presence of God. Awakening Prayer will not be streamed, so be sure to be here in the building at 6 p.m. One of our core values here at CTC is #generosity. We want to thank you for your generosity and for helping us make a difference in our city and cities all over the world. If you'd like to give, you can text GIVE to the number on the screen. You can give using the multiple offering boxes located throughout the building or on our app at ctcfamily.com. Today we'll be taking communion. If you're in the building, talk to one of our ushers for the elements. If you're watching online, you can gather your elements and take communion with us from home. Our verse for this week is found in Luke 6:36. Be merciful just as your Father is merciful. Now let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for everything that you do for us. I thank you that your love is pure and right, and Lord, I pray that you just give us ears to listen to you. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Now let's worship together.
Morning, church. How y'all doing? Who's ready to worship today?
Rattling. mercy seat, now I'll taste it. It's not hard to see, only you can satisfy. There's honey in the rock, in the rock. There's honey in the rock.
Of God. When I grew older, when I learned more of Him, I gave my life to Jesus. He healed my arm from having to get surgery. He sowed His love through healing. God is a kind God. I am ready to get baptized. Today I am going public with my faith.
Mila, Jesus said every disciple should be baptized in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And because of your confession of faith, today I baptize you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins, and according to Scripture, you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit.
church, who came ready for an encounter with Jesus today? Come on, the name above every name, right? Jesus. Can you say that with me? Jesus. Let's declare that name together again. Jesus. Come on. Let's keep worshiping, church.
Jesus at the center of it all. Jesus at the center of it all. From beginning to the end, it will always be, it's always been you, Jesus.
Come on.
Jesus, nothing else matters. Nothing in this world. You're the center, and everything revolves around you. Jesus, you at the center of it all. Yeah. Oh, we worship you, Jesus.
Jesus be the center.
Center of my life.
Just asking that today, come on.
Jesus be the center of my life. From beginning to the end, it will always be, it's always been you, Jesus. Yeah, oh Jesus, nothing else matters.
Jesus be the same.
it's all about you. Only you, Jesus. No other name can satisfy. Only Jesus, the name above every name, the only name that can save. Just Jesus, just Jesus. Oh, oh, oh. This church is worshiping right where you're at. Lift up worship today.
God is already in the house. He's already here with us. He lives in you. It's because of him that you live, you breathe, you have your being because of the Lord. But also the scripture talks about him being with us in the gathered assembly. The presence of God is in this house. But when we engage in the Lord's Supper at the table of the Lord, we also recognize the very presence of God. reminding us, affirming to us, assuring us that he has indeed given his life, broke his body, was broken for our salvation, and his blood was shed that we may have eternal life. It's a wonderful thought to know that we stand as a redeemed, forgiving, hope-filled, love-filled people of God. It's the reason why we rejoice. It's the reason even after we take communion, we give a shout of hallelujah, because we acknowledge in the fact this is what our God has done for us through his Son, Jesus Christ. If you're here and you've accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, I want you to take your elements. We're going to pray and we're going to commune together. Father, I want to thank you for the opportunity we have to reflect upon the death of your Son, Jesus Christ, but also acknowledge what is meant for us and to rejoice, Lord God, for the salvation that we have. We thank you for it. In Jesus' name, let us eat together. And let's drink together. Hallelujah. Come on, let me hear it. Hallelujah. He's worthy of it. He's worthy of it. He's worthy of it. It's good to see you. Good to see you in the house. Why don't you take a minute to greet someone, hopefully somebody you don't know. Just touch base with them, introduce yourself, welcome them to CTC. Good job. Good job.
Thank you for joining us. If you're ready to give your life to Jesus, be water baptized, join a City Life group, learn about the heart and history of our church, join a serve team, or if you're interested in attending this month's open house, we want to know. Stop by and talk to one of our serve team members at the Connect table or fill out that digital Connect card online. Now let's welcome our pastor.
Yes, we are ready, ready, ready. Just a reminder, VBX starts tomorrow. Tonight we'll be doing awakening prayer, and which we're excited about. I do want to say this. This will be our last awakening prayer on a Sunday evening. Beginning in July, awakening prayer will move to the first Thursday night of the month. First Thursday night of the month. And just to simply tell you why, we're trying to relieve some of the pressure on the calendar for the teams on the weekend, and so trying to give Sunday nights a night for families at least try to be together. So we've had to look at a lot of things to see what's going to work best. Thursday night for prayer time may be a challenge for some of you, but can I just tell you, we started with Sunday night prayer. I think we started with 12 people, and it built up to well over 100, almost 200. So if you got a heart to pray and you can make it, you may have to do a little readjustment on your schedule. We'd love to see you on Thursday nights starting in July. But tonight will be our last night of awakening prayer on a Sunday night. we're certainly going to pray going into VBX. Going to pray over the team that will be leading VBX. We got our worship team is leaving to New Mexico this afternoon. We'll be praying for them. And so we'll see you tonight at 6 p.m. VBX starts tomorrow morning. I knew I was going to mess this up. But if you're registered, you know what time you got to be here, right? So I could just leave it at that. In the evening, 6:30 to 8, I'll be teaching here in the sanctuary. I have several things that I'm going to work through on. My whole idea is dealing with doctrinal issues and how we determine which ones are, this is where we die on this hill for this doctrine, this is where we draw the line, where some things are very important for our practice and what those doctrines are, and some things are just like, okay, some people believe this, some people believe that, it's not worth fighting over. So those are the things that I'm going to be dealing with during the evening sessions for VBX. Wednesday night, my dear friend Vince Harmon from Christ Lutheran will be teaching the VBX on Wednesday night. For many of you, and I think I'm going to talk a little bit about this during the week, there's two or three groups of pastors that get together on a regular basis, which I think is really a real blessing for our community, for our city. We don't all agree on the same things. That's some of those things we're actually going to teach about. But we love spending time together. We love praying for each other. We love praying for our city. And with the statistics of everywhere else around the country of church attendance going down, that is not the same in Yuma, Arizona. More and more people are coming to the saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I think it's because, obviously, we pray for our city. And I think it's because pastors sit down together and pray that the Lord Jesus Christ will help us in all that we do. So that's a great joy. So VBX starts tomorrow. It's always one of the funnest weeks around here, full of energy, full of life, full of activity. I want to thank you for your generosity. You certainly have been a faithful church that has allowed us to have some impact in some various parts around the world. I will be sharing with you, we will be doing a church plant of all nations, believe it or not, in Venezuela. So I will be giving you more information on that. Those church planters will be actually leaving this week. And so God is helping us to do what God has called us to do. And it's because of your love, your generosity, your love for the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. So thank you for doing it. Every time you come into the building, you can give in one of the offering boxes. Many of you have got it set up automatically, and thank you for doing that. Well, we're going to pray, and then we're just going to get right on into the Word. Actually, why don't we do this first? Why don't you go ahead and stand first? Take out your Bible if you have it. Hopefully you got a Bible that you're holding on to. I'm pretty sure the ESV of what I'm going to read is going to be on the screen, but let's stand. I'm going to read verses 6 through 11. Today it's just going to be a plain old, good old, always good, life-giving gospel message. Amen? No fluff, no stuff. I'm not putting on any Raiders gear. I'm not coming out with any Dodgers mascot. Just going to preach Jesus. How about that? You ready? I didn't tell you what. Now, what chapter did we leave off last week, folks? Thank you very much. Chapter 5, Dan Winters. Romans chapter 5, verse 6. That's the one thing that I think is great. You know before you get here where Tyrone Jones is going to be. Just going to pick up where we left off from the last week. We love going through the Bible. Amen? All right. Romans chapter 5, Lady V, verses 6 through 11. Here we go. For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person, one would dare even to die. But God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since therefore we have now been justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God. For if while we were sinners, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son, much more now that we are reconciled, shall we be saved by his life. More than that, we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we've now received reconciliation. Can you say amen? Let's pray. Father, I want to thank you for the glorious opportunity we have to be together in your house. We worship together, we sing together, we lift up our hands together. We use our voices, Lord, to acknowledge you. You are indeed at the center. It's Christ that we exalt. Even, Lord, in the preaching of the word, we're asking you to help us to exalt Jesus Christ. Lord, may the word of God connect with every one of us, that we may embrace, for many of us affirm, for some reflect upon what Christ has done to save us indeed from his wrath, that we might have a life that is full of eternity. Lord, we thank you for it. I pray for Bethania. Lord, pray for them. Pray for their pastor, their team, their leadership. Lord, I ask you that you grant them grace in their part of the vineyard. Lord, we pray for our plants, Lord, around the world, that you would continue to be a blessing to each one of them as the reports just keep coming in on how well you're helping each one of those leaders to impact their part of the world. We're thankful, Lord God, for to be able to hear your word. With all the things, Lord, that we hear in the world and all of the challenges that we face, all of the things that can just crash into our mind, into our thinking, let the word of God today bring peace. Let it bring hope. Let us be reminded of your love. And let us leave this place glorifying you. In Christ's name we pray. May the people of God say amen. Man, you may be seated. I want to talk about a salvation to rejoice about. Just a simple topic, actually, a salvation to rejoice about. And there's all of us, I think you know the word rejoice. It's an emotional word. It's a feeling word. It's that response we have when various things happen in our life. We rejoice when we saw the dear young lady getting baptized today. That's the right response, to rejoice. It's not as much celebrating the young lady as it is rejoicing in what God has done in her life. We rejoice when a child is born. Rejoicing when various things take place in life that causes us to be excited. And hopefully, a lot of those things lead us to acknowledge God. Every time a child is born, you know that there's a real work of God that takes place, a real work of God. And so we rejoice when that child comes, and prayerfully, by God's grace, the child is healthy, the mother is healthy, and everybody survives through it. The first time when Jermaine was born, literally, I was so overwhelmed that I literally passed out. You would have thought I was the one having the baby. But rejoicing at the fact of what indeed God has done. And it's important for us that when we talk about salvation, there's nothing really more important. It sounds like a mundane statement that the most important thing that we should be acknowledging and celebrating in our life is our salvation. But I do oftentimes think that as Christians, we can get so caught up in the things of life that the rejoicing that we should have because of what Christ has done gets lost in the mix. I think it's one of the reasons why every day for a believer should be a joyful day. It doesn't mean it doesn't have challenges, but it's joyful. It doesn't mean that there's not problems. It doesn't mean there's things that you have to overcome. But at the end of it all, it settles in the fact that I can yet rejoice in the God of my salvation. Nothing that's going to take place in this very moment, in this very trial, is going to take away from what Jesus Christ has already done for my life, for eternity. Am I talking to the right church? It can never be taken away, no matter what else takes place. So in the writings here in Romans, that's where Paul is leading us to before he kind of breaks down how there's this distinction between Adam and Jesus. And so we've already discussed about the blessing of being justified by faith. That's where it all begins. That's the must. And because of that justification, there is that peace with God. Because of justification, we stand in the grace of God, and we got access to him, and we live in the hope of glory. All that is in justification. Last week, we talked about even during trials and tribulations that we still yet have joy because of what they do. Build up character. We learn to persevere. Our character is built up. We learn what it means to endure and to trust and to have a hope in God. And it's that hope that anchors our life. It anchors our soul. It keeps us stable. It keeps us on the right path. It keeps us looking forward, again, in spite of everything that may be going on in life. And how do we know that we can stay there? Well, verse number 5 says, because the love of God is poured into us. It's a constant. That love is in us for all of eternity. It's an assurance. God is assuring us, I am with you. Why? How do you know? Because my love is poured in you by the Holy Spirit. And so five brief thoughts I have because of that. And what he does in verses 6 through 11, he lets us know that our salvation is entirely of God and his love. It's entirely of God and his love. Both aspects is very much important. When we were utterly helpless, Christ came at just the right time and died for us sinners. Entirely of God. No aspect of us has caused this, done this, can even make this happen. And it is indeed because of his love. When we think about the great salvation that we have, we see that God extends his love to sinners. In spite of us, in spite of what we've done, actually even everything that we have done, his amazing love to us is not based upon us getting our act together or because we deserved it. Many people kind of hesitate to make a commitment to Christ because they say, well, they haven't got their act together. None of us did. None of us got our act together. It's not like we qualified ourselves to say, okay, God, now that I've fixed me, I'll come to you. Well, if you fixed yourself, then why do you need him? Why do you need him? So it's not that we fix ourselves, that we're able to get ourselves on track. It's not because of even our performance that guarantees that there's this flow. It's absolutely because of God's love alone. John 3:16, as common as it is probably one of the most overlooked verses in all of Scripture, because it says this: for God loved the world in this way. This is the CSB. He gave his one and only Son, that everyone who believes in him will not perish, but have eternal life. That speaks to every one of us. It speaks to us. It certainly tells us that love gave. But it tells us that God gave love on purpose. God gave love with the desired end, that everyone who was convinced of his love would indeed believe his love to save them. And that's exactly what's taking place here, so that we will not come to ruin, will not perish. It's an undeniable fact that those who have rejected the Lord Jesus Christ, they are on a mission to perish unless there's a rescue, unless there's a saving. But he says, because of God's love, in whom we believe, we will not come to ruin. We will not perish. 1 John 4:9 says it this way: God's love was revealed among us this way. God sent his one and only Son into the world so that we might live through him. It's this life. That's the real life that we're looking for. Every one of us, I'm sure, have goals. We got hopes. We got dreams. There's things that you want to accomplish in this life. But ultimately, the life that we're looking for is the one that's provided by God for eternity. Live through him. And so when we read those words, that it was surely God's love, then you got to stop for a moment and think about the character of the people that God died for. As a matter of fact, this passage says, it says a couple of things. It says it's not unlikely that maybe somebody will die for someone that's what's considered an upright person. An upright person. As a matter of fact, the scripture says it this way. For one scarcely will die for a righteous person or an upright person. So it's not like it happens often, but it's possible that it can happen, that someone can die for someone that they really don't have a relationship with, but for whatever reason, out of a goodwill motive, they can put themselves in the place of someone else who might would die based on what's happening. Maybe tried to push them out of the way of a moving car at the cost of them being hit themselves, whether they know the person or not. He did go on to say, though, that though perhaps for a good person, one would even dare to die. And we can think of the multitude of stories that we've heard from our servicemen, military men, first responders, where they know that the end result of this was probably them dying, but it may save another. The unfortunate thing about all that, the good part about that is absolutely that there are still people who have that kind of heart. And honestly, every one of us should in some manner have that kind of heart without the thought of knowing what may come of the end of this, yet it saves another. I read an older story of a sister who had some kind of disease, and the family knew that if she didn't get this blood transfusion, that she would die. She had a 14-year-old brother who the writer did not describe him as what you would consider a good citizen, but he had a love for his sister. And sure enough, the 14-year-old goes to gives his blood, and after his blood is drawn, he actually looks at the doctor and says, okay, now when do I die? Because his thought was, I'm giving myself so that my sister may live. That's the kind of wording that Paul is using here. It's possible that people will give their life for one that they know they have a relationship with so that they may also live. But Christ went beyond that. Christ didn't die for upright people. Christ didn't die for good people. Christ died for absolute sinners. Absolute sinners, the character of us. I guess this is probably a right place. You can call us deplorables, but the character of that is our deplorable condition, where the scripture defines us as helpless people, ungodly people, sinners and enemies. Look at the breakdown. He says that we're helpless, that we're absolutely incapable of working out any righteousness for ourselves. We don't have the capacity to do it. We don't have the ability to make ourselves good. Lloyd-Jones said it like this: we're total inability in a spiritual sense. A total inability in the spiritual sense. We don't have the ability to even see the good of God. Christ had to come and do something in us so that we can even spiritually recognize that there was a Savior dying for us. We lived in death. We lived in the death of sin. The scripture says that's the manner that we formerly walked. There wasn't a good nature of us that said, yes, 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 Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. It takes him to come and extend his love for us even to be awakened to the ability that we can be saved. He says clearly we're not able to save ourselves. Nicodemus was, according to the scripture, a good man, a Pharisee, one who loved God and loved the people of Israel. But even when he went to Jesus, Jesus said to him, unless one is born again, you cannot even see the kingdom of God. Can't even see the kingdom of God. So just as much as we're not able to even produce our own natural birth, we certainly don't have the ability to produce our own spiritual birth. Paul even goes on to say that we weren't even seeking after God. None that understands, none who seeks after him. So we were absolutely helpless people, weak people, totally unable and absolutely unwilling to do anything to help ourselves be reconciled to God. So we were weak and helpless. He says that we were ungodly, that all of our ways are so different from God. Our thoughts are different from God. Our ways are different from God. We're so unlike God that we're chasms apart from him. There's no human way that we can cross that chasm because of our ungodliness. He says that we were sinners. It's another term that he uses here. And we read this and dealt with this in Romans chapter 3. All of us have sinned and come short of the glory of God. That's just the indictment, and that's the truth. And verse number 10 says that we were enemies of God, hostile toward him. And I know I get it. We've talked about this. Probably none of us would walk around and say that we were enemies of God, but yet we didn't want his lordship. We didn't want him to be the Lord of our life. We were alienated over that. When you read these things, it can almost be depressing and basically tear down our self-esteem. But I think that's the good news. The good news is we don't want to glory in our own self-esteem, because our own self-esteem can be dealt with and manipulated by emotions and things that take place in life. Whether I'm still acknowledged and admired in a relationship or not, that can crush my self-esteem. Or if I failed at a particular task or at a job, it can crush our self-esteem. We're not built to live upon our own self-esteem. It's the esteem of Christ that we need, that we live upon. It's as depressing as it may seem. If you don't recognize the depths of sin from which God rescued you from, you'll never appreciate the greatness of his love. You'll never appreciate the greatness of his love. Christ didn't come to help us polish up our self-esteem. That's not what he came to do. He didn't come to help us make us feel good about ourselves. He didn't die for us so that we can reconcile ourselves unto God. He came and died for helpless, weak, ungodly enemies and sinners. That's who Christ died for. Titus chapter 3 says it this way, verses 3 through 8. It says, "For we too were once foolish, disobedient, deceived, enslaved by various passions and pleasure, living in malice and envy, hateful, detesting one another. But when the kindness of God, our Savior, and his love for mankind appeared," catch this, "he saved us." It wasn't until the kindness of God appeared, it wasn't till he came with his love, that man was saved. Not by works of righteousness that we had done, but according to his mercy. Through the washing and the regeneration and the renewal by the Holy Spirit, he poured out his Spirit in us in abundance through Jesus Christ our Savior, by whom we've been justified by grace, that we may become heirs, the scripture says, of eternal life. He says it's a trustworthy saying. Listen, I want you to insist on these things so that those who have believed God might be careful to devote themselves to good works. These are good and profitable for everyone. It's a worthy saying that Christ indeed died for sinners. By no means is salvation a works-based thing at all. Christ didn't come help us to save ourselves. He didn't come to just kind of give us a spark of the potential that's within us. Not at all. Christ came absolutely saving us from the fear, from the doubt, from the sin, from the shame that every one of us was in. It wasn't our loveliness, it's the constancy of the love of God. I read Karl Barth, which I certainly don't ascribe to all of his theology, but he certainly got this right. He was a Swiss theologian, and in one of his sessions, somebody asked him, "What was the greatest thought that has ever gone through his mind?" And I think everybody was expecting some deep thought, which is normally where Karl Barth would go. But after a pause, he said this: "Jesus loves me. This I know, for the Bible tells me so. That's about as profound as it gets. Jesus loves me, this I know. Can you say amen to that? And because he does, then now we can rest assured that we've been saved from the wrath of God. Wrath is always a hard word, right? Wrath is it's just a hard word. We don't like to think about wrath on anyone. And here is the real issue. Whether you like the word or not, or the word may be too strong for you, here's the bottom line. There is a justice of God that comes upon mankind. There's a justice that's undeniable. And everyone, listen, we are wasting our time if we're here every week reaffirming that Jesus Christ could save us, if there is no other alternative. If there's no consequences for not receiving Jesus. Can I just say this? If everybody gets to go to heaven no matter what, then why in the heck are we here? Why are we here week after week, hearing the scriptures, hearing what Christ said? If in the end, everybody gets to go to heaven every week, if you say, well, I do believe everybody gets to go to heaven every week, but I just come here to learn how to be a better person. You can turn on any pop psychologist instead of come listening to me hollering at you for 45 minutes every Sunday. If you just want to learn how to be a better person that ends up where? A better person for life to go where? End up how? A better person for what? Everybody within us knows that there is something beyond this life, because eternity is born in our heart. Everybody knows there's something beyond me. There's something beyond us. There is a greater authority beyond us. There is a life beyond this. The only way we hook up into that life is to hook up into the Creator, the God who made all of life and eternity through his Son, Jesus Christ. And if that be true, which I absolutely ascribe it to be true, then there is another alternative. The other alternative is to reject this God and to reject this Savior. And the wrath of God that we talk about, and the scriptures talk about what that may look like, I don't think there's a clear description to any of us, but here is what I do know. There is an alternative of those who rejected him, and that is the very fact of the justice of God coming upon mankind. But here's what the scripture tells us. When other people may be living this life afraid of death, not one person who knows the Lord Jesus Christ should have a moment of fearing death. Not a moment. Because on the other side of that, as a matter of fact, the scripture says it like this, that we pass from death to life. Not a moment. There is no fear. Sure, we all have thoughts of maybe how we want to die and don't want to die. I just got news for you. You really can't write that script. We just don't know. That's not a script that God gave you the authority or liberty to write. But what I can tell you, even though I have thoughts of how I don't want to die, I can absolutely assure you I'm not afraid of dying. Because I know this, there is not the wrath of God that awaits me on the other side, but absolutely the welcome into the eternity before the Savior for all of life. There's a saving from God's wrath. A saving. These two verses, verses 9 and 10, to me are some of the most assuring scriptures in all of the Bible. Some of the most powerful arguments, because it lets us know of this final salvation that we who believe in Jesus will find. There's three stages of salvation, as you probably well know. The one that we've been talking about the most is justification. That's the work of Christ that's already been done. It's a past work. The moment you believe in Jesus Christ, you're justified. That very moment. For by grace you have been saved through faith. So the very moment you believe in Jesus Christ, you are already delivered from the penalty of sin. What am I saying to you? You don't have to worry about going before God at the great white throne judgment and be afraid of him throwing sin back at you. that you failed at. The moment that you receive Jesus Christ, you're already justified. Every one of your sins have been done away with. You will never have to hear about your sin before the Almighty God because he died for it already. He's not going to bring up what he died for. He's not going to bring it up. Y'all doing all right? That's justification. Now we're being sanctified. That's the present work of salvation in us. The scripture says it like this. I don't think this will be on the screen. For the word of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it's the power of God. Christ working in us. We're being sanctified more and more to conform to the Lord Jesus Christ. We're in that process as we have received the salvation of the Lord Jesus Christ. And then there's that third and final stage, the one that I hope that all of us are looking forward to, not rushing into, but looking forward to, the one that I hope gives us the peace, and that's the glorification. There's that final deliverance. We've already dealt with the penalty of sin. He's already dealt with that in our lives. And now we're dealing with the power of sin, where sin no longer has any power of us. But then there's glorification, that final deliverance, that when we go before the judgment seat of Christ, once and for all, we're delivered from the presence of sin. Once and for all, saved from the wrath of God, that wrath that refers to God's judgment, that wrath that comes upon those who reject him, that wrath that comes upon God, however God exercises that, certainly ends with an eternal damnation. We are saved from that wrath. Because why? Christ's blood has delivered us. We've been saved. We've been justified. As John 5:24 tells us, truly, truly, I tell you, anyone who hears my word and believes in him who sent me has eternal life and will not come under judgment, but is passed from death to life. It can be one of the sweetest moments of our life, honestly. As oxymoron as that may sound, that moment when we pass from this life into glory can be one of the most glorious moments of our life, not fearing the wrath and the judgment of God. In the meantime, the scripture says we are now reconciled unto God, no longer enemies of him. We dealt with this, I think, more so probably two messages ago. It's a wonderful word of reconciliation. It absolutely means that there are some people that are enemies of God, but the scripture says we're not. We're reconciled. God's going to judge everyone. All mankind will be judged. But we stand in a place of reconciliation where we're no longer at odds with him. He cannot have fellowship with those that are in darkness, but we're not living in darkness. We're walking in the light. We're walking reconciled. It's a beautiful thing as a pastor to see a husband and wife, people that's maybe in a difficult marriage, be reconciled, or see estranged children reconciled to their parents. It's even more joyful to see people reconciled to the Almighty God, coming to him. 2 Corinthians 5:18 says this: everything is from God, who has reconciled us to himself through Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. That's the thought. That's the idea. We're no longer at hostility with God. Why? Because of the cross. Colossians 1:21 and 22 says this: once you were alienated and hostile in your minds, as expressed in your evil actions, but now he has reconciled you by his physical body through his death. Hear this: to present you holy, faultless, and blameless before him. What a moment. What a day. And you may think, how in the world will I ever get there? Like, do you ever wake up in the morning and say, hey, by the way, thank you, God, for everything that you've done, but I'm the most blameless person on the planet. Oh, hey, Virginia, good morning. Good to see you. I'll go make your coffee. Just watch this most holy man go make your coffee. No, 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 no. No, no, because this is what we understand. That's a work that God is doing in us day by day by day so that he may be able to present us holy, faultless, and blameless. How is he doing it? Because of the work of the Lord Jesus Christ. And it's there, and this is where we'll end, and team, you'll come, where that whole idea of rejoicing comes in. This is what we know about rejoicing. If the truth is the truth, if I believe absolutely what these scriptures say, if I have no doubt in my life that I have trusted Jesus Christ for my salvation, then why wouldn't I rejoice? Why wouldn't I rejoice? It's got to be the most exciting thing in my life. Because it's the one thing in my life that's the constant, that's an assurance, that cannot be taken away. Everything else that you can get excited about, you can lose excitement. I'm telling you, yesterday on the golf course was, again, one of my most embarrassing moments, where it was a putt, a long putt. And I'm telling you, I'm watching that putt. I'm going to say about 30 feet, I would say. I'm watching that putt, and everything about me saying, it's going in. There's four other people with me. It's going in. It's going in. It's going in. And I dropped my thing. I'm already shouting, and that ball went around that hole as if little arms shot out the ball and says, I'm not going in. I'm not going in. I'm not going in. I'm not going in. And just rolled right on the side. I was already cheering. The people with me looked at me and said, you just missed. You can get excited about things. That excitement can be taken away. But you can't fail rejoicing in God for your salvation. There is no God pushing you away. There is no accidents. There is no mishaps. Because everything was done by him. And he said, because of what I've done, you can absolutely rejoice. That's why we get through trials and tribulations. And that's why even in death, we die, as the scripture says, gloriously. Because we absolutely know from this point on, I got nothing to fear. My God is my Savior. And it's a salvation worth rejoicing about. Listen, church, there is no reason at all why any one of us as believers should not live a life full of hope and full of joy. Again, I can't mark your days from here till eternity, and neither can you. But this is what I do know. The scripture tells me I can rejoice, always rejoice. My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God, my Savior. Can I tell you why? No matter what yesterday was like, I can wake up this morning with a heart full of love and full of joy. Not because I fixed the problem yesterday, but because the same God, my Savior, is keeping his promise and still saying, you belong to me for all eternity. It's not what I can fix or what I can change. It's what he's fixed and what he's done. Everybody stand if you would. You know, we often talk about with people, I guess, yeah, just on a side note, all of us know people who we deal with on a regular basis. And we may even say to ourselves, man, I just wish they could be happy. I wish that they could be happier. They can. They can. They can be happier if you help them get to the same Jesus that's given you joy. You see, this message certainly is about what I want you to know. I want you to know that you can rejoice, but I also want to know what tell you what you can do. And that is, you can help others get to that same place of joy that you experience in your life every single day. by helping them also know that Jesus Christ has died on the cross, not just for you, but also them, because they were in the same boat, helpless, weak, ungodly, sinners, enemies, just like you. And isn't it better, isn't it true, that people will listen to the message of Jesus Christ when you tell them what Jesus has done for you? Because you were no different than they were, no different than they were, yet the joy of the Lord is in my heart. Every head bowed and every eye closed. Prayer team, you can come. I think we're going to go back into this song, Jesus is the center of it all. And he is, and he is, and he is. These folks here will be here at the altar. They'll be here to pray with you for whatever you need. But I just want to remind you of this. The scripture says we can go from death unto life, but that's only by trusting in Jesus. If you're here today and you don't have that heart of joy, if you have any uncertainty about what would happen to you, if you were to lose your life tonight, if you were to take your last breath today, I'm telling you right now, the only one that made a promise that you can go from death to life is Jesus, because he's the life giver. If you're in the house, heads are bowed and eyes are closed. If you're in the house and you haven't trusted Jesus for that life, that new life, that eternal life, but you're here, you want to trust him today, you want to begin that new life, and this is your first time saying, I want to trust Jesus. If you're here and you haven't done that, you can just lift your hands where you are. I'll pray for you where you are. The Holy Spirit is speaking to you. God bless you. The Holy Spirit is drawing you. The Holy Spirit, God bless you. I see your hands. The Holy Spirit has certainly convinced you, I need that joy, that life. I need that. Today's the day that you can make that commitment. Let's pray with those who have lifted their hands for the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's pray together. Father, I thank you. I said, let's pray together, everybody. We got some folks here who just made a commitment to Jesus Christ. Can we just pray with them and let them feel part of the welcome with the family? Let's pray together. Father, I thank you for sending your son, Jesus Christ, to die for my sins. I thank you for his love that fills my heart as I receive him today as my Lord and Savior. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Come on, let's celebrate Jesus. If you've made that commitment for the first time, you certainly, I'm going to invite you to come and let one of these dear people know here in the front. If you need prayer for anything at all, they're here for you. We're going to go into the song, Jesus is the center of it all. And let's leave here rejoicing, knowing and believing that he is indeed the center of our life. God bless you. Have a great morning.
Jesus, be the center of my life. Jesus, be the center of my life. From beginning to the end, it will always be, it's always been you, Jesus. And Jesus.
church. We love you. We love worshiping with you. You're dismissed. Be blessed.